Welcome back, geology fans. In our last episode, we covered the part of this chart that covers the structures formed when rocks are stressed in various ways and respond with brittle strain. Today, we look at the ductile strain structures and add one more low stress but brittle strain structure at the end. We start with compressive stress and ductile strain, which results in folding. Take a piece of paper and push its ends together and it will bend rather than break and thus make a fold in the paper, not a reverse fault. We will break folds into more subtypes in a moment, but to start with, there are two main types. An upward fold with the crest at the top, which is called an anticline, and a downward fold, which we call a syncline. One way to remember the difference between synclines and anticlines is that the anticline looks a bit like a capital letter A. Synclines look more like the downward-pointing V shape and the Y of syncline. But generally, these forms are below ground, and so we look to their surface expressions to tell a syncline from an anticline. Recall back to our relative age dating episodes in which we discussed the law of superposition, which says that layers on the bottom are older than layers on top. If we take a bunch of layers and bend them upward into an anticline, and then shave this feature down, at the surface we will see a repeating sequence of beds with the oldest material in the center. To the left of this central oldest bed, the younger flanking layers all dip to the west, and to the right of this center of symmetry, all beds dip to the east. So an anticline has beds dipping away, outward from, the central bed, which is oldest in the center. As you might expect, things are reversed in a down-warped syncline. The center bed is the youngest, as it was formerly on top, and the beds on either side dip inward towards the central youngest bed. In a syncline, beds get older as you move away from the center of the fold. With an anticline, beds get younger away from the center. But nature is messy, so what if a fold, be it a syncline or anticline, has a plunge into the earth? In other words, what will it look like at the surface if the fold ridge is not horizontal but tilted? Imagine taking a bunch of layers and making them into an anticline, and then dipping that fold into the ground and shaving it off level. Instead of symmetrical layers and stripes on either side of the axis of symmetry, we see a V shape form at the surface. With a plunging anticline, we will see the oldest layers in the center still, and youngest layers on the flanks, and the layers all dip away from the center of symmetry, just like with any other anticline. The V shape at the surface also tells us which direction the fold is plunging into the earth. With a plunging anticline, the V points in the direction the fold is plunging into the earth. With a plunging syncline, the V points in the opposite direction of plunge. But as with any other syncline, the youngest beds are in the center, and all flanking beds dip inward towards the center of symmetry. Besides level and plunging synclines and anticlines, we can further classify folds as being symmetrical or asymmetrical. Isoclinal, when the limbs parallel each other. Overturned, when one limb ends up upside down. Similarly, overturned recumbent, when the fold axis is near horizontal. And chevron, when they zigzag. Regardless of specifics, almost all folding is the result of compressive stress and ductile strain. But shear can come in during folding to create what are known as drag folds within larger compressive folds. Also note that we get one other type of fold from ductile strain and shear stress, the monoclinal fold. This last fold type looks like a layer of rock was bent in its middle without disturbing the orientation of the beds on either side. If one considers this fold in formation, it is easy to see that if it continues, the stress will eventually cause brittle strain and make a fault, with signs of fault drag, bent rock on either side. What type of fault a monocline may finally become depends on what type of stress is causing it, as we discussed in our last episode. But we put monoclinal folds in the shear stress portion of our chart. If it's pure shear stress, then this would make the monoclinal fold eventually break into a strike-slip fault. But we can imagine any incipient fault type as starting as a monoclinal fold, possibly, and thus we must be careful assigning stress to a monoclinal fold unless we have more contextual evidence, such as surrounding faults of the compressive, reverse, tensional, normal, or shear strike slip types. If everything around you says compression, you might lean towards compression in less certain cases. As we get further into field geology, you will hear me say more and more that nature doesn't like to be pigeonholed, and that we must always keep context in mind. We have one last square to examine in our stress-strain combinations, tensional stress with ductile strain. This results in a form known as boudinage, which comes from the French boudin, which means sausages, as this rock structure looks like a series of sausage links, either joining or disconnected from each other. If we take silly putty and stretch it, that is, apply a tensional stress, slowly enough that it deforms with ductility, we see that it tends to thin in one area while allowing other areas to stay thick. Rock can do this too, and if you have a problem with the idea that rocks can flow like silly putty, recall our old friend the metaconglomerate with smushed pebbles which flowed under the right conditions of heat and pressure. So if we see boudinage, we know the rock was pulled apart with tension while under enough heat and pressure, and at a slow enough rate that the rock deformed with ductile strain into the classic sausage shapes of boudinage. Before leaving the basic structures, I have to dip back into the area of this chart with brittle strain. The faults we described last episode are all due to brittle strain and have large and rapid enough stress to cause movement across the broken surface. So a fault is defined as a break in the rock with movement on either side. But anyone who has spent enough time around rocks knows that rocks can break but have no relative movement across the break. In that case, we call the break a joint, not a fault. And since a joint can be made by weaker stress of any kind, we will overlay joints across all stress types, though with knowledge on how various joints form, we can usually say what type of stress produced it. Like lava flows cool from the top down, and since cooling rock is contracting rock, we can get randomized centers of contraction which cause tension in the rock, popping it apart in columns that migrate from the top of the contracting lava to the bottom where cooling and contracting occurs last. The result is these vaguely polygonal columns commonly seen in lava flows called columnar jointing. The twisted patterns seen in columnar jointing can be due to thermal properties of the lava causing the cooling to develop in a non-linear, non-vertical manner. But columnar jointing can, like our combination faults, have a bit of shear stress as well as tension or compression causing them. Joints which have a bit of shear stress on them will often produce what we call feather structure. These feathery patterns in the rock often originate from a point or small area of initial failure and blow out from there. Looking in the direction the feather structure opens out tells us the direction of the shear stress that helped make the joint. In this case, the rock the feather structure was in was pushed down, and the face that it was against, but is now gone, was pushed up. That motion will cause the resulting fracture pattern seen here. The joint pattern seen around Arches National Park near Moab, Utah, is caused by salt below the sandstone and other rock units dissolving and flowing out from underneath. The arches seen in Arches are there because of the jointing in the area. Faults, folds, and joints are very important not only for telling the history of an area geologically, but in controlling surface processes involved in erosion and deposition, and so a knowledge of geologic structures is very important in understanding landforms that we see around us in nature. There's a lot more to structural geology than knowing the basic faults, folds, joints, and boudinage patterns, and I will touch on these in later episodes, but I hope in the next few episodes to get my viewers up and running with basic field geology, so we will save more complicated structural geology concepts for later, and plunge into the basic method used to measure and report structural data in the field. Rock beds, faults, lava flows, fold axes are all planar features, and if you have any familiarity with geometry, you know you can define the position of a plane with two intersecting lines in the plane. When we come back next time, we will cover the very important geologic concepts known as strike and dip, here on Earth Explorations.